But joining us in the studio is a security expert, Tony Ofoyetan. It's good to have you in the studio, Tony.
Thank you very much.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Right. Let's start it this way. The attack by herdsmen has been ongoing. And up till now, there hasn't been any definite move by government that controls security, that ensures the welfare and well-being of all citizens as to what strategy to put this behind. What is really going on?
Well, I think the first thing is the lack of political will to decisively deal with the situation. Just like we spoke about the insurgents, Boko Haram insurgents, and whether we like it or not, to some extent, previous government and present government, they all, as much as they could, try everything possible to make sure that it doesn't spread beyond certain region, especially the northeast. And we also saw what happened, even though the corruption came in along the line and all those stuff. But the fact remained that at a time, you could see that the government was becoming very endemic. And because of that, the government intervened. And today, to a large extent, is suppressed. Now, if the government could take the same approach, because I must tell you that the herdsmen insurgents now is more devastating. It's worse than the Boko Haram. Why? The reason is simply because the Boko Haram insurgents is within a particular locality in the country. But this one is a national issue. I'm not too sure of any, except states like Sokoto, Katsina, Sokoto, Katsina, Kano, Jigawa at one time or the other, some not states that have not been really affected, very few. You see that almost every state, okay, maybe except also Lagos State.
Okay, what about the argument? But you said that the Boko Harams have been, they've been tamed, as it were. But there are arguments that some of these men, herdsmen, so-called herdsmen, are not really herdsmen. They are people, perhaps, who from the Boko Haram side who went silent on the other side.
Who were dislodged.
They came back here.
Insecurity, all variables are very important. And there's no variable that you disregard. No matter how small, no matter how minute. I'm very sure that if you gather all of them together, definitely some of them would definitely have come from the Boko Haram sect or sector. Now, but the fact also remained that while Boko Haram was going on, we had pockets of attacks in some states, even in the heat of the Boko Haram crisis in the country. Fulani herdsmen were also doing theirs in little, especially in Jos then, in Benue State to some extent. But now, it's because the Boko Haram thing had gone down, not eradicated. Now you now see that the Fulani cattle herdsmen are taking over. So it becomes a very viable argument to say that it's more or less like a metamorphosis. But like I would say, the whole thing will come down to the government because you are talking of a situation where the Minister of Agriculture come all out to say that these are not Nigerians. I remember that one of the devastating attack on Benue State, when Nigerians were really crying and were shouting, and that of Enugu State, where 80 people were killed overnight. And it, in short, the irony of it all was that because of the structure we have in this country, where the Commissioner of Police had to get the leave of the IG before dispatching his men, and the IG had to get the leave of the president before instructing the Commissioner of Police. Within that period of time, the cattle herdsmen were able to capitalize on that lacuna before you knew what was happening. 80 human beings had died. I'm not too sure. It's not too many of Boko Haram attack where you have 80 human beings dying within a very short period of time. As far as I'm concerned, I think that the government should really come all out. I've had reports of where military officers were deployed to Benue State, and they went to the village and The villagers were saying, look,
so the problem
this
is not the issue of intelligence gathering. Are you saying that the security men get the wings of this attack?
It's not a matter. You see, intelligence is imperative in security. Every little step you take in security, intelligence is more or less like the torchlight. It's more or less like the torchlight to direct you where to go, what to do when you get there, and how to do it. That's what intelligence does. But as it is now, you are talking of people that are hibernating in the forest, basically for the purpose of perpetuating evil. Look at it, the scenario I gave, when they attacked the village in Benue, and the people are saying, look, these people are inside the bush there. Mm. And the soldier said, we are not asked to go into the bush. And the people are like, look, your stay here is not useful to us. Your being in the village here is not useful to us. These people are right inside the forest. And they said they did not instruct us to go into the forest. That speaks volume. It speaks volume. And it comes to the issue of what value do we place on life? Because if you have a government that places value on human life, and not to begin to say that it was just one person that died,
yes,
it's so insultive, it's so annoying for any government official or security agency to say, no, the press, they over-exaggerated it. It was not 20 people that died. It's just one person that died. Each time I read such things, I feel pained. I feel as if that person that they said that should be the direct family of that, whether commissioner of police, IG, or even at whatever level, then you will now see a different approach entirely. But because they are peasants, they are farmers, they are so far away from the seat of power, they count human beings as numbers. Until government begin to play value on human life, then we may not have a headway.
There are issues of conspiracy, the conspiracy theory that we hear that, okay, that even sometimes the policemen, perhaps the army, they know these men who perpetrate this evil, but that even when they arrest some of them, after a while, they release them.
Now, there are so many factors that are in it. The issue of religion, we cannot shy away from that. Now, the issue of the ownership of the cow, we cannot shy away from that. Those who are backing the herdsmen, we can't shy away from that. And that's just the truth. From our simple understanding, most of these cows are owned by generals, retired generals at whatever level. Now, you now look at a situation like that. The police officer that has been deployed to maintain the peace in a particular locality understands better than you do that these people are rearing these cattle on behalf of a general, a major general somewhere, who has also armed them. Now, at the end of the day, if they perpetrate any act, before he goes in to do anything, he wants to get the leave of his boss. His boss wants to get the leave of his boss. And at the end of the day, what happened? Human beings are dying. And unfortunately, this is the only country in the world that I hear that government value cow more than human beings.
All right. There's been some arguments here and there that these attacks are not carried out or perpetrated by Fulani, as it is peddled sometimes as a case may be. But let us assume, like the Minister of Agriculture, Dr. Audrogbe, sometime has said that some of these herdsmen are not Nigerians. Now, if we had to take it from that perspective, if he has authority to say, or he knows the truth or the fact that these attackers are not Nigerians, then is it okay for anybody from anywhere, Senegal or Cote d'Ivoire or Mali, to come to Nigeria without maybe passports or without the authorized process of being in Nigeria, without documentation, to just come, perpetrate evil, and then you just say they are not Nigerians?
Now, you see, that is one of the reasons why I said, this is, it's a very funny situation where, look, let's take, for example, the grazing reserve bill. Mm-hmm. Now, if you say that some of these people are not Nigerians, one. Secondly, cattle rearing is a private business. It's not a national business. Mm-hmm. Now, at the end of the day, what do? You took a bill to the National Assembly to legalize and legitimate a private business and businesses that are also, that foreigners are involved. Foreigners without documents. They don't have where they stay. They don't have family. We don't know them. Now, unfortunately, they're also killing our people. It's sick volume.
Yes, if you bring a government friendly official here now, for them.
There will be a defensive argument. But the question is this. Are you going to defend the foreigner against your own people?
Citizens.
Make legislation in favor of a foreigner against your own people? I don't think that is the true position. I think that the government is seriously backing up the, what do you call, the cattle herdsmen. If the government is not backing them, government knows what to do. This is a geographical expression that there is nowhere the government, even the Sambisa forest we are talking about in this country, severally the military has launched several attacks on the Sambisa forest we are talking about. These people that you are talking about, are they in forest bigger, more complex than Sambisa forest? These are people that even the community, the villagers know where they are. When they attack at nocturnal hours. When you make a distress call, what is the time response of the security agencies? These are issues. Now, before you talk about time response, it means that there must be specific express order from the high authority down to the lower security agency that peradventure there is attack of this nature. You have 3 minutes response time. If you give the police or the soldier such instruction, I bet you that there will never be one attack in this country. I know they are competent to do what they ought to do. But the issue is this. They want to save their jobs. They don't want to venture into what they are not instructed to venture into. That's why you can see a security agency. He will fold his hand and will be looking at people being murdered. And you say, why are you not responding? So God never thought say make her do anything. And that is just the tradition of the profession.
Exactly.
But you can't blame it.
Perhaps that's the case that played out in Taraba, where there was a call, a distress call to the police command there, and the response they got was that the road was bad and they didn't have any vehicle to go and rescue the people.
There are so many
sometimes there are complaints
excuses.
There's no fuel.
So many escapist excuses. But like I would say, it is the precedents right from that top there. There have been a lot of allegations, there have been a lot of accusations. A president is the president or the cattle rearers in the country and all those stuff like that. No matter how weak the excuse, no matter how weak the argument is, there is something to bring out of there. It now behoves on the president, which is supposed to be the president for all, to not come all out. If you say, I will deal decisively with the Niger Delta Avengers, I will deal decisively with Boko Haram, and you have not said I will deal decisively with the cattle Fulani.
No, he gave an instruction after the Enugu attack. What
happened?
But perhaps that should be the question. What happened?
Look, you are talking of daily attack and nobody has been apprehended. Nobody has been brought before any court of law. To even say that these were the people that perpetrated this act. Recently, Foscar King was killed in Plateau State. At the end of the day, within 2-3 weeks, it's gone. And that is just our culture in this country.
Okay, let's look at the localized vigilante groups in some of the warlord, as it were, in Masob, for instance, in Enugu, and we're already talking tough, and OPC in this part of the divide are also talking tough that, okay, if the government will not protect them, they will protect themselves. Do you foresee a case where you have quite a number of proliferation of arms even been exacerbated?
There are already proliferation of arms in this country. No thanks to the politicians. During electioneering campaign, they armed their so-called thugs and boys. And after the election, when they leave, then the boys have multiple use or reasons to use the gun. But what I'm seeing and I'm foreseeing is that the government is a culture of violence has been laid down already, and it's most likely going to come into full bloom if the government did not take decisive action. Because whether you like it or not, some governors have said we have forest guard. Nobody needs to be deceived and say they are going to be protecting our trees and the like. As far as I'm concerned, it's as good as saying that we need to now protect ourselves. Under whatever guys, Ekiti State came and said that, hunters, you are armed. I give you money, go and buy bullet and all those stuff like that. OPC is coming to say, if you try it, we are ready. The Egbesu boys are saying, now the danger is this. You only know the beginning of a fight. Mm. You don't know the end. Now it is at the, you know, within the terrain of the government now, not through the instrumentality of force, but taking steps that will make people to trust the judgments and the steps of government to that they are able to protect all, irrespective of your religious divide, irrespective of your ethnicity, that the government is for all. Because if you ask now, an average Benue man will tell you that this government is not their own government.
All right, let's take it back to, let's take it to Benue State, like you were saying. We reported earlier that the provost of the College of Education in Katsinala, Dr. Matthias Nda, has said that many students are now dropping out. They can't pay school fees and all of that. Now, this is from, because some of their parents have either been killed by the herdsmen, or some of them are in IDP camps and so on. Now, what's the long-term implication of a situation like that?
The long-term implication is that we most likely may be having food crisis. That is one of the long-term implications. And also you see situation where some villages may not recover again. Mm. Basically, because as we speak now, it's not just insulting that the cattle, the herdsmen had sacked them, they are taking over their villages. Mm. They are establishing themselves and entrenching themselves in such villages. What are we talking about? Are you saying that the old woman should go and... Ah, no, I don't think the government... Look, this issue is not a matter of propaganda. You are talking of life here. It's not a matter of we are doing something. Within 1 week, the government can sack all the herdsmen in Benue State. All of them. All of them. There has been several arguments why move in contemporary society, in the world, you don't see grazing. What you have are cattle ranches. Private cattle ranches, which makes a lot of sense, it gives a lot of peace. If you have two variables, one variable will cause crisis, another variable will give peace. And incidentally, the other variable that will cause crisis, you are not in any way whatsoever directly involved in such business. For goodness sake, it makes sense, security-wise, and even in morality, to go for the one that will do what? That will make peace. Look at what the governor of Kwara State said. He said it categorically that, as far as he is concerned, that cattle business is a private business. Let them go and build ranches. Let them buy the land and build ranches and take care of their cattle there. Mm. If you have chicken, for goodness sake, and your chicken is going to disturb your neighbor, won't you know how to protect your chicken or get your dogs?
Get a chicken coop.
I'm not doing stuff like that.
So okay, is that in the meantime, before the government acts, what can the ordinary people do? Those villages where these attacks are paramount. What can? Is there any security measures they can take? Is there anything they can do to at least stay safe?
The defensive measure they can take is to constitute themselves into local vigilante groups. That's the safest thing, as far as I'm concerned, they can do as it is now. Yes, constitute yourself into local vigilante groups, and if possible, have situation wherein you have good communication network with security agency that is closest to you. Peradventure, any attack at any point in time in the night or at any point, then the security agencies would get the information as early as possible. Then those people that come to their villages and they are not too familiar with, they should not allow them in the village. Once anybody comes to your village, under any guise, village is a small community. Mm.
And you are everybody not too knows
sure,
everyone.
Yes, you are not too sure of those people. Whatever, guys, don't allow. It has come to the stage where it's not a matter of we are all Nigerians. No, we are not all Nigerians now. And government functionaries have also said it.
They've confirmed
that we are not all Nigerians. And since we are not all Nigerians, and it's not written on the forehead, and the government has not taken pain to give necessary document to everybody to say, show me your papers. Mm. Then when you see any foreigner or any stranger in your community, before that stranger, settle down, sack that stranger.
All right. Tony Ofoyetan, thank you very much for coming on TVC Breakfast.
Thank you.
Thank you.